Hello, I'm Graham and welcome to today's video. In this video, I'm going to discuss the manual exposure that you can create with the Panasonic Lumix FZ200 or indeed any other camera with manual exposure control. Manual exposure isn't ideal for every type of photographic subject. If your lighting changes between scenes, if the subject changes, if the position of the camera changes, then you're likely to have to go through the procedure for setting manual exposure each time you want to take a shot. What it is useful for is things like manual panoramas, where you want to keep the consistency of exposure throughout the whole series of exposures. Or if you're doing something like focus stacking, again you want consistent exposure throughout that range, and the manual exposure allows you to do that. Of course, if you want to use a manual exposure meter as well, then you can use that and set the camera according to the metering scale on your exposure meter. A lot of people find it difficult to comprehend how you set the camera up in the manual exposure mode. They have some sort of difficulty understanding what's called the exposure triangle. Now, I'm showing the exposure triangle on screen now, and you can see it's a diagrammatic representation of the three principal components of exposure. Top of the triangle is ISO, and ISO is basically the camera sensitivity to light, and you can change it from the lowest sensitivity, which gives you the best digital quality image because it has the least noise, to the highest sensitivity, which allows you to use the camera in extremely low light conditions, but at the expense of introducing some digital noise. And that's why I've put the red arrow down from the ISO, signifying that if you increase ISO, you will increase noise in your image. Ordinarily, I would recommend you always keep the camera set at the native ISO. So that's the lowest ISO that the camera supports, without going into the extended range. So for example, on the FZ200, it's ISO 100, as you can see on screen now. On the left-hand side of the equation, you have aperture, and again, I've put an arrow linking to depth of field. Now, depth of field varies with the aperture. It also depends upon the zoom setting you have on your camera, so the focal length of the lens, and also on the camera to subject distance. Each one of those will impact on depth of field. But if you just want to control depth of field with the camera set to a specific telephoto setting and a specific distance to your subject, then the aperture will give you that control. A larger opening in the diaphragm, a larger aperture, will give you shallower depth of field. A smaller F number, like F8, will give you more depth of field. And if you're having trouble understanding the relationship between aperture size and depth of field, then if you imagine the aperture to be a fraction. So with the aperture at f2.8, if you consider that to be a fraction of 1 over 2.8, almost one third, it's much bigger than if you take it at f8, which is 1 over 1/8. So that's an easy way to remember which is the smallest aperture. The bigger the number, the smaller the aperture. It's the inverse logic, if you like. So we've seen now how aperture will affect depth of field. On the other side of the triangle, we've got shutter speed. Now, shutter speed is responsible for the amount of light going through the diaphragm of the lens and reaching the sensor. The amount of time that subject is exposed will determine the amount of subject blur. If you've got a static subject like we have on screen, then obviously subject blur isn't a particular problem, and you can set the camera up on a tripod and take whatever exposure you need to get the right exposure. If you're shooting something like a sports event, then obviously the subject's moving quite quickly and you'll need to use a faster shutter speed in order to arrest that subject motion. So the exposure triangle just is a relationship between the three components, and you'll decide which one of those is the most important for that particular exposure. Here, with my tabletop shot, I want to get maximum depth of field. So I'm going to select an aperture of something like f7.1. I won't use the smallest aperture of the lens because that introduces what's called diffraction limited resolution, and it gives you a slightly softening effect. So I'm going to come back a third of a stop and change that to f7.1. In the center of the diagram, you'll notice I've got a scale going from -2 to +2. This is a diagrammatic representation of the way the metering circuit works together with the ISO, the aperture and the shutter to indicate whether you've got the correct exposure or not. If I quickly change to the manual mode by turning the top control dial to the M position, and you can see that on screen now with an M in the top left hand side of the screen, this exposure indicator is the scale at the bottom of the camera here, as I'm indicating. It's not exactly the same as exposure value compensation that you use in the aperture or shutter priority modes, but does give you the same effect. Here it's indicating to me that the camera is overexposing by two-thirds of a stop, or two-thirds EV. So the metering circuit, and I've got this set up for center weighted, is telling me that with the exposure times I've got now of a 13th of a second, and with the aperture of f7.1, and with an ISO of 100, the resulting image will be overexposed. To correct that, I ought to bring the scale so it's back to zero. And I can do that by either changing the ISO, the shutter speed, or the aperture. Now, we've already discussed we're going to have maximum depth of field, so we're going to set that to f7.1. I want minimum noise, so I've set that to ISO 100. So the only component left in the exposure triangle is the shutter speed. And by varying the shutter speed, it will vary the amount of exposure index that's shown on the screen. We're overexposed, so I need to shorten the exposure to bring this right. So I need to go faster than 1/13th of a second. So if I go from a 13th to a 15th, I come back 1/3 of an EV. And if I go from a 15th to a 20th, then I've gone back two-thirds of an EV. So now there is no indication on the screen, so that means the camera is correctly exposed. If I take that shot for you, and I've got the camera set up with a remote release, so I can take that without having to reset the 2-second timer each go, you can see that we've got exposure highlights blinking, and I've got exposure highlight turned on. And if you want to set that on your own camera, then it's in the setup menu, and you'll find it on page 4, and you just need to go down to highlight and turn that on. It's a useful feature, but you can get into some difficulties if you follow it without due consideration as to what your subject is. Here I've got this tabletop scene with deep shadows and lots of specular highlights and things like the shiny chrome on this car, this seal which has got fur, which has got plenty of detail in, but if we overexpose the highlights, we won't see any detail there at all. So that is what the exposure is telling me now. And if I go into a preview mode, you can see that area is blinking. Well, there will be areas which are totally burned out. There'll be no detail in those highlights at all. So what I would routinely do is to always bias the exposure. So in the same condition as you are in sort of aperture priority mode or shutter priority mode, to be about two-thirds of a stop underexposed, and that will control the amount of highlight loss. So to achieve the equivalent of using two-thirds of an EV underexposure, we need to again shorten the shutter speed one more time. So the next third of an increment gives me a 25th of a second, and if I want two-thirds underexposure, I need to go to a 30th of a second. So it's basically I've dialed in extra shutter speed until I've got two-thirds of a scale showing on the exposure index. Now if I take that picture, you notice there are no highlight warnings, or there are just two or three pixels showing on that seal. So that's a good indication, and if we go into the preview mode, that I've got a good balance between the highlights and the shadows. Obviously, there is a finite range at which the camera can capture both the highlights and shadows, and that's called the dynamic range. And dynamic range is affected by the type of sensor, but also on the size of the sensor. And generally, the smaller sensor cameras like the FZ200 doesn't have as much dynamic range as the full-frame sensors like the Canon 5D. So we aren't going to expect a full range of highlight and shadows to be captured with this type of camera, so it is a compromise. If you go too far, and you go now to minus one EV by going one more step on the shutter speed. Again, I'll take that shot using the remote control. Now there are no highlights showing, but the particular scene looks to be slightly underexposed. I can compensate for that if I post-process this image, or if I'm shooting raw. Again, I could use the full raw controls to bring back some of the shadows and highlights. But the more you underexpose an image, the more you're going to introduce noise into particular areas like the shadows. So it's best to shoot as high as possible towards the overexposure side without clipping the highlights, and that will maintain the best type of image for you. So a recap, to get the exposure to where you need, you need to change either the aperture, the shutter, or the ISO, dependent on your scene type. So for example, if I balance the exposure index to 1/20th at f7.1, if I wanted a shallower depth of field, then I'll change the aperture by pressing in the top control dial to give me control of the aperture control. I can change that to f2.8, and you see as I change to a larger aperture, the camera is showing me that I'm exposing to the right, I'm overexposing, and the scene will be lighter. And a useful dodge in this manual exposure mode is to half depress the shutter button. It gives you not only a preview of the depth of field, but it also gives you a preview of the exposure that you'll capture using that particular setting. As you can see, the picture looks totally washed out, and that's indicated by the exposure scale. Now, you don't see that in any other mode except in manual mode, so it is a useful feature. So I've gone to f2.8, so to get the exposure right again now, I need to change the shutter speed to a faster shutter speed to reduce the amount of overexposure. So to get control of the shutter speed, again, I need to press in the top control dial to gain access to the shutter control, and then to make this shorter to give me the correct exposure, and then I want to go one click more, two click more to give me the 2/3 of an increment, which will be the same amount of underexposure as we had with f7.1. So again, if I take that picture, it will be the same exposure as the first one in terms of tonality, but obviously the depth of field will have changed because we're using a smaller aperture. Just briefly to talk about exposure metering, I've got the camera set up for center weighted. So if I go into the quick menu, you can see that I've got center weighted selected. If I was to change to multimetering, then that would consider more of the image for use with the meter. If I went over to spot metering, then it just takes the very small area that the cursor is showing you on the screen. So if I move the camera around, you notice that on the magenta square, which is the same tonality as the grey square, the exposure stays around about the same degree, minus 1 EV under. And if I move this to the black square, if I just slacken off the camera and I move it over to the black square is under the cursor, you notice now we've gone to 1 2/3 stops under. So if the camera was being used to meter in this mode, if I set the metering to give me the correct exposure based on that black square, when I take this picture, the whole image again will be overexposed because we're targeting on an area that isn't neutral grey or hasn't got about an 18% reflectance. So if you're using spot metering, you must be aware that you should use something like the normal 18% reflectance target, which is a third spot on here, and then adjust your shutter speed on that target area. So there we are, manual exposure mode on Panasonic cameras. In summary, we've seen the exposure triangle and the interrelationship between the ISO, the aperture and the shutter speed, and the consequence of changing the values. So you get more noise for higher ISO, you've got more depth of field going to a smaller aperture, or you'll get more blur going to a lower shutter speed, and that is indicated in the exposure triangle. It's up to you to determine which of those key components is going to be critical for the shot you're taking, and then set up the camera accordingly. Hope you found that interesting and it's demystified the process of shooting in manual exposure. Remember, it's not for every scene. If your lighting changes, if your camera position changes, if your subjects change, then again, you'll have to balance the exposure meter by using any one of the controls that you've chosen. So it's not for every scene, but a useful mode nevertheless if you want to be a little bit more creative in your photography. So that's it for the video. Thanks very much for watching. If this is the first time you visited the channel and you like what you see, please click the subscribe button and then you'll be notified if I do upload any new videos to this channel, and they'll be in your subscription list. I also have a photographic blog and I'll put a link to that in the video description below. If you subscribe to that blog, you will get a weekly newsletter and that will give you access to areas that are not open to the general public, and you can get access to hints and tips, my download manual for the FZ200, and lots more topics of photography. So until my next video, thanks again for watching. It's Graham saying take care and goodbye for now.